I will just start.
Yes, please.
Good morning, everybody. Today, we have gathered here under the organization of Academy of Physics Teachers Kerala, under the hosting of Academy of Physics Teachers Kerala. This event is the third memorial lecture of in memory of Professor M.C. Valasubramanian. I think many of you may be, maybe most of you may be familiar with Professor Valasubramanian and his works, but there may be a few new students who may not know him. So I'll just introduce his legacy to the new audience. Professor M.C. Valasubramanian was born in 1952, and he was a renowned physicist and a teacher from Kerala. He was a scientist at IGK Kalpakkam till he superannuated as outstanding scientist and head of materials physics division in 2002. And since then, he had been a distinguished professor at Hyderabad Central University and IIT Palakkad. He was a versatile researcher. And some of his works on open quantum systems and statistical mechanics became landmarks in those years. His research interests span from quantum field theory to computational material science. He's also remembered as an inspiring teacher with a deep understanding of different branches of physics and mathematics. Professor Valasubramanian passed away in 2019. And since that year, APT Academy, he was an honorary member of Academy of Physics Teachers Kerala. So this organization has been arranged memorial, annual memorial lecture since 2019. This is the third such lecture. Today our chief guest is going to deliver the memorial lecture is Professor V. Balakrishnan sir. He is a distinguished professor from IIT Madras. We all know him from his teaching in different areas of physics, in theoretical physics. Many of his YouTube lecture series under the NPTEL repository, they have been very famous. So we are very happy. IPT is very happy that we have Professor V. Balakrishnan sir has agreed to spend time with us, and today he'll be talking about a fundamental area in theoretical physics, particle in a box, a basic paradigm in quantum mechanics. So on behalf of Academy of Physics Teachers Kerala and on behalf of all of us gathered here, I cordially invite Professor V. Balakrishnan sir to this program. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
And I think our Google Meet meeting has the number of people who have joined here has reached the limit around 100. And we are also live streaming this program in our YouTube channel, NPT's YouTube channel. So I welcome all the people who have gathered here. There are students, there are teachers, there are friends and colleagues of Professor Valasubramanian. They have been here in the previous two annual programs also. So I welcome all friends and family of Professor Valasubramanian sir and students, and also the teachers and other students from different states, including from Kerala and also outside. Welcome you all. And I invite Professor Titus K. Matthew, sir, president of APT, preside over this program.
Thank you, Hari. Without any delay, I think we can go to the lecture. But for formality, I welcome you all APT members and chief guest of the day, Professor Balakrishnan, other distinguished guests and students. This is a great occasion to APT to remember and commemorate Professor M.C. Valasubramanian, who was a well-wisher of APT and also resource person to many of our lecture series. So we remember him with great thanks and with all your permissions, without any delay, let me invite Professor Balakrishna to deliver the lecture. So sir, over to you, Professor Balakrishna.
Sir, can you call Rishmi to introduce the speaker?
Yes, of course.
Good morning to all. Professor V. Balakrishnan earned his BSc honors and MSc degree in physics from University of Delhi and his PhD in theoretical high energy physics from Brandeis University, USA in 1970. He was a postdoctoral fellow at TIFR from 1971 to 1974. And then a scientist at IGR Kalpakkam from 1974 to 1980. He joined IIT Madras as a professor of physics in December 1980 and retired as professor emeritus in December 2013. He has held visiting positions at several institutions abroad. He is currently adjunct faculty in the Department of Physics at IIT Madras. His research interests have spanned many areas over the years, including particle physics, many body theory, condensed matter physics, random walks and stochastic processes, nonlinear dynamics and chaos, and quantum dynamics, on which he has published numerous research papers and articles. He has co-authored Beyond the Crystalline State, Springer in 1989, and authored Elements of Non-Equilibrium Statistical Mechanics in 2008 and in 2021, Mathematical Physics in 18 and 2020, A Miscellany of Mathematical Physics, Indian Academy of Science 2018. Over four decades, he has taught a wide variety of extremely popular courses at the undergraduate, master's, and doctoral levels, comprising all the standard subjects in physics as well as some new non-traditional ones. He has received high accolade for his teaching at IIT Madras and his lecture at numerous courses sponsored by UGC, DST, and ICTP have been well received by their attendees. He has given seven video courses under the auspices of NPTEL program of MHRD, which are available on YouTube. These have received very high acclaim with a total of several million views worldwide. He has been a fellow of Indian Academy of Science since 1985. His current research interests are in quantum dynamics, random walks on fractals, and recurrence statistics in coarse-grained dynamical. We welcome you, sir, for this talk. Thank you.
May I start? Am I audible?
Yes.
Just adjust the volume.
Sir, is it full screen now?
So can we start?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I should thank all of you for this great honor bestowed on me to give the Varsha Kumar Memorial Lecture this year. I'm very grateful to Dr. Hari Krishnan and the Academy of Physics Teachers Kerala and the organizers of this lecture for this great signal honor. I should also make a special mention and of thanks to Mrs. Leela and Veena, Valsa Kumar's family members. There seems to be a problem with the audio. Just a minute. I'll start with a couple of personal reminiscences about Valsa, my friend. In 1976, I think, when Valsa Kumar first came to Kalpakkam from the BRC training school, fresh out of the training school, the young product of the training school, he came and he joined, and within a few days, we had a paper circulating at the time. Myself and a few others had co-authored this paper. And within a few days, this young man comes up to me to my office and says, I'd like to see this preprint that's circulating. So I gave him a copy of the preprint and he went away. And then a week later, he came with a long list of typographical errors and other errors, mistakes in the little calculations that had been done, plus suggestions for what else could be done. This was absolutely amazing that within a week or so, this young man had actually spotted several errors and gone through the paper carefully and had essentially refereed the paper for our, on our behalf. So I realized that we were dealing with something very, very special. Cut to several years later, after I left Kalpakkam, we stayed in touch throughout. And around 92 or so, I was working with a student on a problem in Random Box at IIT Madras. And I got stuck at one point. I had a solution to a certain problem and didn't know if it was right or wrong. And I had no idea of checking, no way of checking to find out whether it was right or wrong, because it would take too long to explain to the third party what the calculation was all about. So I took recourse to Valsa. I sent him a letter and said, this is the problem, and do you have any ideas about it? And sure enough, a week later, there arrived a thick letter with the solution written out in great detail, which in the meantime, we had also found and corroborated what we had done. So the result was the paper that was jointly co-authored between my students, myself, and Valsa. And then in the same year, the work was extended at his suggestion, and there was a second paper which arrived not too long thereafter. Unfortunately, we didn't have the opportunity to collaborate after that, but I'll never forget these incidents. And later, when Valsa moved to Kerala from Hyderabad, the director of IIT Palghat, Professor Sunil Kumar, casually mentioned to me that he was going to have Professor Valsa Kumar teach at IIT Palghat. And he said, do you have any suggestions or comments? I said, well, since you've already got a whole department to teach there in the form of Professor Valsa Kumar, you don't really need anybody else in the department. And he laughed. And this was really true of Valsa. He could single-handedly foray into various parts of physics and provide deep insights into a subject which only he was privileged to have. Let me get on with the lecture itself. The topic I've chosen today is something which I think Valsa would have really liked and appreciated. It has to do with a basic paradigm in quantum mechanics called the particle in a box. So if I may have the first slide, please. So the problem of a particle moving inside a box, freely inside a certain specific region of space with rigid, perfectly reflecting walls, is a very standard exercise in basic quantum mechanics. And progressively in the textbooks, you do this in one dimension, two and three dimensions by taking the box to be a line interval or a square or a cube and so on. This problem illustrates a very large number of aspects of quantum mechanics, such as stationary states, uncertainty relations, and all the other vocabulary of quantum mechanics. In this talk, what I'd like to do is to provide some insight into how this problem acts as a kind of model or paradigm for understanding not only these, but many, many other aspects of quantum mechanics itself. So in the next slide. We'll also see how the same problem leads directly to non-trivial matters such as quantum chaos and deep results in mathematical physics. What's important to emphasize here is that this is not a textbook exercise, the particle in a box problem. With modern technology, this problem is actually physically realized in many different kinds of nanostructures, such as nanowires, atomic corals, quantum dots, conjugated polymers, and so on. So it makes it all the more important to understand precisely and properly various problems of this class and their solutions. Next slide, please. This is a brief outline of the talk. I'll start with a particle on a line interval and then go on to a one-dimensional space without a boundary, namely a ring, and then move to two-dimensional cases, considering the particle in a square box and a circular box, two different kinds of symmetries. Say a few words about dynamical billiards. Mention the particle on a sphere, particle undergoing geodesic motion on a sphere in quantum mechanics. And then move, if time permits, to the inverse problem by way of Weyl's formulas and trace formulas and make a few concluding remarks. This talk is largely based on an article in Resonance that's to appear shortly. The next slide, please. So just to refresh your memories for the students, in the one-dimensional case, we have a particle of mass m confined to a region 0 to a of the x-axis. There's no force on the particle when it's inside this region. Classically, the particle is described at any time t by its position and momentum variables. In quantum mechanics, it's described by a state vector psi of t, which changes according to the Schrodinger equation. the Hamiltonian operating on the state vector gives you the time rate of change of the state vector. What is required is to find the stationary states of the particle, namely the eigenstates of this Hamiltonian. We'll work in the position basis because that's the one that's most familiar to beginning students, in which the state vector is represented by a position space wave function psi of x comma t, which is the inner product of the bra x with the state vector psi of t. The next slide, please. What's interesting is to ask, what happens if the momentum operator p acts on the state vector of the system and it's represented by the wave function xp psi of t, which, as everybody knows, is minus ih cross the gradient with respect to x of psi of xt. The time-dependent Schrodinger equation for psi of xt is this well-known equation, ih cross t over dt psi of x comma t is the kinetic energy term acting on psi plus the potential energy v of x on psi. The potential itself is not zero, even though we call it a free particle, because there is a box, and the edges of the box provide an infinite potential. So v of x is zero for x inside the box, and it's infinite on the box and for x outside the box as well, by implication. It's important to notice that although there is no force on the particle inside the box, there is certainly an x-dependent potential v of x given above. And since x and v of x don't commute with each other, the momentum does not commute with the Hamiltonian, which means the momentum of the particle is not conserved. Next slide, please. There's a little technicality here which I must mention, because this is the sort of exercise that Valsa would have enjoyed, really. It's a technical point, but it's a very important point, and it's usually not talked about at all. In order to represent the linear momentum of the particle by the derivative operator, the operator d, which is minus id over dx, must be a self-adjoint operator on the space of square integrable functions in the interval 0 to a, so that its eigenvalues are real and represent the physical momentum. But while d is a symmetric operator in this sense, the bra df with the ket g is the bra f the ket dg, it's not Hermitian because it's unbounded. A Hermitian operator, strictly speaking, is a symmetric bounded operator. Nor is this operator self-adjoint, because in general, the domain of the adjoint of d is bigger than the domain of d. But in this case, it turns out to be easy to show that the so-called deficiency indices of this derivative operator are equal, implying that D has a one-parameter group of self-adjoint extension, family of self-adjoint extensions over this space. We don't have this problem because we're going to restrict ourselves for physical reasons to wave functions that vanish at the two endpoints of the interval. And therefore, this operator is guaranteed to be self-adjoint and the technicality is taken care of. Next slide, please. May I have the next slide? The standard technique is to separate variables by assuming that the wave function is a product of a function of time times a function of space alone, and use the fact that p on phi of x is the derivative of phi of x. And you get the time-independent Schrodinger equation for psi of x, which is an ordinary differential equation of the second order, with the kinetic energy term here, the second derivative term, plus the potential times e for psi of phi of x. Notice that this is now an eigenvalue equation for the eigenfunction phi of x. And since v of x is infinite outside the box, the probability density must identically vanish outside the box. By continuity of the wave function, then, implies the boundary conditions phi of 0 is 0 and phi of a is 0. So we need to fix, we need to find the solutions of this differential equation, the second order differential equation, time independent Schrodinger equation, given the boundary conditions that the function phi of x vanishes at the two boundaries of the interval. These fix the values that are allowed for the energy E. The next slide, please. Well, the way you solve it is standard. Inside the box, the potential is zero, so you just have the simple harmonic oscillator equation, and the solutions are of the form A sine kx plus B cos kx, where k squared is proportional to the energy of the system. Imposing the boundary condition, we easily see that the cos part vanishes and you have a wave function proportional to sine kx alone, and you get this A fixed by normalization. And the second condition is that the K must be equal to N pi over A, where the quantum number N runs over 1, 2, 3, the natural numbers. Therefore, the energy eigenvalues and corresponding normalized eigenfunctions are given here. En, E sub n, is proportional to n squared times a constant, and phi n is proportional to sine to n pi x over a times the normalization constant. And outside the box, phi n of x is identically zero. The next slide, please. Let's do a little dimensional analysis in this problem. There are three parameters in this problem: the mass of physical dimensions m, the length of the box, which is physical dimensions of length, and Planck's constant, whose physical dimensions are ml squared t to the minus 1. From these, you can form a single unique combination, h cross squared over ma squared, with the physical dimensions of energy. Therefore, the energy must be proportional to this combination, as indeed is the case. Since the wave function is normalized to unity, phi n of x is the physical dimensions of 1 over square root of length. Therefore, the factor 1 over square root of a, the prefactor in phi n of x, is also explained, apart from a numerical constant. Why is there no dependence on Planck's constant in this time-independent wave function phi n of x? That's an interesting question to ask. After all, this is quantum mechanics, and we expect Planck's constant to appear everywhere. But the answer is that the only combination of physical dimensions of time in the problem is ma squared over h cross. And if there had been an independent time scale tau, if there had been one in the problem, then you could have expected a dimensionless combination like tau h cross over ma squared to have appeared in the time independent wave function. But as it is, there is no such independent time scale tau, and therefore this function phi n of x has no Planck's constant dependence at all. So it's a simple argument, but worth keeping in mind. The next slide, please. The next question we want to ask is, can we get the same answer by a simpler method? And it turns out in this case, for fairly serious technical reasons, that the old Bohr quantization rule yields exact energy levels in this example. Well, classically, the particle bounces back and forth between the walls of the box at the two ends, and they act as perfect reflectors. The momentum of the particle remains unchanged in between collisions and changes sign every time it hits a wall. For any given energy E greater than zero, the momentum of the particle is square root of 2me when it's moving to the right, and minus square root of 2me when it's moving to the left. The phase trajectory in the XP plane classically is therefore a rectangle of height twice this value with the width a. Bohr's quantization rule then immediately says integral p dx over the closed orbit must be n times Planck's constant, and that if you solve for E turns out to give you exactly the correct answer, n squared h squared over 8ma squared. Next slide, please. So it's worth bearing in mind that the energy is quantized because of confinement to a compact region. The next question we're going to ask is, why is the energy level proportional to n squared? Can we understand that by a physical argument? Well, for that, what one has to do is to consider not just the particle in a box, but a whole family of potentials. V of x is kx to the power 2r, but k is a positive constant and r is some positive number. Look at this family of potentials. They're confining potentials about the origin. Classically, the phase trajectories in this case are simple closed curves in the XP plane, and they're simply given by ovals, symmetric ovals centered at the origin, given by this algebraic equation here. For any given energy E, the motion is periodic with an amplitude E over K raised to the power 1 over 2R. The trajectory intersects the P-axis at square root of 2ME, the plus or minus, excuse me. So the area enclosed, even though we don't solve this problem exactly, we can find out the proportionality on the energy of the area enclosed by the phase trajectories, and that's of the form e to the power r plus 1 over 2r. It's a very simple argument, and the next slide tells you what happens if you put a quantization condition on this. Integral p dx is nh immediately tells you that the energy raised to this power is proportional to nh. Therefore, the energy level En is proportional to n to the power 2r over r plus 1. If you put r equal to 1, you get the r squared potential, which is the oscillator. for the x-squared potential. In that case, we recover the well-known result that E sub n is proportional to n. In the simple harmonic oscillator, linear harmonic oscillator, when n is much bigger than 1. As r increases, the potential becomes steeper and steeper, and in the limit r tending to infinity, you have the infinitely steep walls of a particle in a box, and therefore, taking the limit of n to the power 2r over r plus 1 as r tends to infinity, we recover the answer En is proportional to n squared. So you see, this is an example of what's called invariant embedding, because you embed the problem in a family of problems and solve the general case and look at your special case as a particular case for a special value of some parameter. So that works in this case, and you indeed get En is proportional to n squared. It also tells you that in this class of problems, you cannot have any dependence on n whose power is greater than 2. This is the kind of limiting power that you have here. The next slide, please. Various general quantum mechanical properties are also illustrated by the particle in a box. The energy spectrum is fully discrete. Each phi n of x can be chosen to be a real valued function of x. The energy levels are non-degenerate since the coordinate is one-dimensional and simply connected. We'll come to that a little later. Also, in a one degree of freedom system, there can be no constant of the motion f of x, p independent of the Hamiltonian. The ground state has no nodes, the first excited state has one node, and so on and so forth. And then the nodes, there's an ordering theorem for the nodes. These are standard properties in quantum mechanics for this whole class of problems. The next slide, please. There's the orthonormality condition on the wave functions, the completeness condition. And another interesting point to note is that the Hamiltonian is symmetric about the midpoint of the box. And if you translate to that point as the origin, the Hamiltonian is unchanged under the parity transformation, x prime goes to minus x prime, which is a discrete symmetry. That immediately implies that every wave function is either an even or an odd function of x prime. And indeed, we have seen that the ground state is an even function, it has no nodes, the first excited state is an odd function, the next one is an even function, and so on. Next slide, please. Then we have the uncertainty relation applied to this particular problem. You'll discover very easily that the average value of the position must be the midpoint of the box. That's obvious. This mean square has a complicated dependence on n. It goes like a squared for dimensional reasons. And then there's a 1/3 minus 1 over 2 n squared pi squared. It saturates to the value 1/3 for n very large. The momentum mean value is zero because the particle is inside the box and is not going anywhere. The box is not moving anywhere. And the mean square value of the momentum is easily found because we've already quantized the energy. It's just 2m times the mean value of the energy, which is this combination n pi h cross over a the whole square. Therefore, the uncertainty in the position and the momentum are easily written down. And the product of the two is in the next slide, please. And it has this expression here. Notice that in the ground state, when n is 1, the uncertainty product is a little bigger than half h cross because the wave function is not a Gaussian, and the ground state in this problem is not a minimum uncertainty state, unlike the simple harmonic oscillator state. The momentum uncertainty increases linearly with increasing quantum number n. The position uncertainty also increases, but much more slowly. And when n tends to infinity, it tends to a saturation value a over square root of 12. But there's an interpretation for this a over square root of 12. It is precisely the standard deviation of a uniform classical positional probability density inside the interval 0 to a. And in the limit, when n becomes very large, delta x delta p becomes proportional to n pi h cross over square root of 12 for n much greater than 1. Next slide, please. Let's look at the momentum wave functions in momentum space. What I'm trying to point out is that this single problem, if you take and look at it from various angles, you get a great deal of information about quantum mechanics in various situations, as we'll see in what in the sequel. Let's look at the position space wave the momentum space wave functions corresponding to the position space wave function phi n of x. Well, since phi n of x is a sine function, it's proportional to this linear combination of exponentials, which appears to be a superposition of two plane waves of momentum eigenstates of momentum plus or minus n pi h cross over a. but that's not true. That's deceptive. Momentum space wave function is the Fourier transform of the position space wave function, and it's got to be this integral which has to be done. In the next slide, we've done that for the ground state and taken the mod squared to find the probability density in momentum of this particle in the ground state, and it has this complicated expression here. And unlike the probability density of the position, which is identically zero outside the box, the momentum space probability density exists for all values of V, of the momentum P, in accord with the Bailey-Wiener theorem in Fourier analysis. Because you have a compact distribution in X, in the Fourier space, in the momentum space, the distribution will be spread out, and in this case goes all the way to infinity and dies down like a power law, which is 1 over P to the power 4. We can even give an interpretation for this 1 over P to the 4, because it must be an even function of P, and P squared average must be finite, which implies that phi tilde of P cannot mod squared cannot decrease more slowly than 1 over P4. It can't go like 1 over P squared, for instance, and therefore there's no alternative but to go like 1 over P4. Once again, it's always a good sign, good thing, to check these answers out with some limiting cases and other physical arguments. In the next slide, I shift now to a particle on a ring. So let's suppose the particle moves on a ring of radius A now, which is a one-dimensional space with no boundary at all. And of course, since there's circular symmetry in the problem, it's natural to use plane polar coordinates, rho and phi in this case. And since phi is fixed at the radius of the ring, the only relevant coordinate here is the angular coordinate phi. And the Hamiltonian is the momentum, angular momentum P phi squared over 2ma squared, which is the moment of inertia, twice the moment of inertia, where P phi is the orbital angular momentum about the center of the ring. And in the position space basis, it's represented by minus I h cross, the gradient with respect to phi. The time-independent Schrodinger equation now has this oscillator-like form, and the linearly independent solutions are e to the plus or minus ika phi. Next slide, please. Since the particle moves on a circle, we must now impose not boundary conditions, but the periodicity condition, capital phi of angle phi is capital phi of the angular argument phi plus 2 pi, which is a very strong condition because it says these two are equal as functions, and therefore all the derivatives are also equal to each other point by point, which immediately implies that ka must be an integer. And this strong condition suffices to determine the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions of the Hamiltonian. Normalized eigenfunctions are given by e to the il phi over square root of 2 pi, where l is 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, etc. Notice that the value 0 is also allowed here, saying that phi of phi is a constant, 1 over square root of 2 pi in the ground state. Negative integer values of l must also be included, because e to the plus and minus e to il phi are linearly independent of each other. The periodic, the probability density phi l of phi mod squared is 1 over 2 pi, a constant for all the eigenfunctions. And we expect this on physical grounds because all points on the ring are equivalent. There's no special point on it or set of points on it, unlike the line interval where the boundary points are distinguished from the internal points. That's an important point to note. The next slide, please. And the eigenvalues, once again, are given by something proportional to L squared. And what's important here is to note that there is degeneracy even though the particle is moving in a one-dimensional space. The energy eigenvalues corresponding to plus or minus L are exactly the same. Therefore, each E sub L except E naught is doubly degenerate with eigenfunctions phi sub L and phi sub minus L. What do these states represent physically? Well, the Hamiltonian is proportional to the square of the angular momentum in this problem. Therefore, it commutes with the angular momentum itself, which implies in turn that the Hamiltonian and the angular momentum have a complete set of common eigenstates. Phi L and phi minus L are eigenstates of the angular momentum with respective eigenvalues L H cross and minus L H cross. So that's the interpretation of phi L and phi minus L. Let's extend this to a two-dimensional domain to a particle in a square box, because there are some interesting things that happen here, even though it's a standard exercise in quantum mechanics. So we have a box, a square box of side A, 0 less than x less than a, 0 less than y less than a. we can extend this to cubical boxes, hypercubical boxes, etc. As before, V is zero inside the box and infinite outside it. And classically, of course, we have a 2 degree of freedom, 2 degrees of freedom, x and y, each constraint to lie in this region. And the canonically conjugate momenta Px and Py are such that the Hamiltonian is just the square of the canonical momenta, the sum of the squares of the canonical momenta, apart from this 2m factor. The particle moves back and forth in the square, which act as perfect reflectors and reverse a certain component of the momentum in sign every time it hits a box, the boundary of the box. The next slide, please. Classically, therefore, we have the square of the x component of the momentum and similarly the y component of the momentum are two independent constants of the motion which commute with each other. The Poisson bracket is zero. Therefore, this Hamiltonian is classically integrable in the Liouville-Arnold sense. The motion is bounded and regular or non-chaotic for all initial conditions. And correspondingly, in quantum mechanics, we expect the spectrum to have behave regularly, to have a regular discrete spectrum. And that's also easily taken care of. The Schrodinger equation is written down here, and we need to solve this. The next slide, please. And the problem mathematically is to find the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions of the negative of the Laplacian operator del squared with Dirichlet boundary conditions, namely the function is zero on the edges of the square. This problem is exactly equivalent to solving the Helmholtz equation del squared plus k squared phi equal to zero for the normal modes of vibration or standing waves of a square drum head whose edges are held fixed. Notice that both del squared and the boundary conditions are separable in Cartesian coordinates. These both conditions are needed. Therefore, the method of separation of variables in these coordinates will provide the solution to the eigenvalue equation. In the next slide, we see what the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions are. They're labeled by two positive integers, n1 and n2. And the eigenvalue En1, N2 is just the sum of the two squares, N1 squared plus N2 squared, where N1 and N2 run over the natural numbers. And the eigenfunction is just the product of the sine functions with N1 and N2 as the in the argument of the sine function. The ground state is non-degenerate, corresponds to N1 equal to N2 equal to 1. As in the one-dimensional case, this wave function has no nodes inside the box. The wave functions of the excited states have nodal lines instead of nodal points, as in the one-dimensional case. This happens as you go to higher and higher states, you have more and more nodal lines. You would have seen pictures of the drumhead vibration modes in classical textbooks on acoustics. Next slide, please. Now for the degeneracy. Well, some interesting features come out here. Since the energy eigenvalues are proportional to the linear combination of n1 squared plus n2 squared, proportional to just the sum, all the levels with n1 not equal to n2 are degenerate because the states phi subscript n1 comma n2 xy and phi n2 comma n1 xy correspond to say the same energy eigenvalue en1 comma n2. Now this degeneracy arises from a very obvious discrete symmetry. The invariance of the Hamiltonian as well as the boundary conditions under the interchange of x and y. But there is an additional degeneracy in this problem. There are further degeneracies owing to numerical coincidences. I don't want to call it an accidental degeneracy, which is what it is, because that word is used for dynamical symmetry, symmetry and degeneracy due to dynamical symmetry in quantum mechanics. But we're not going to, for want of a better term, let me just call it an additional degeneracy. And these degeneracies happen whenever numerically there's a coincidence in the sense that n1 squared plus n2 squared happens to be equal to n1 prime squared plus n2 prime squared. When does this happen? The next slide, please. It turns out that Brahmagupta knew the answer. Interestingly, the Brahmagupta Fibonacci identity tells us when this happens. Brahmagupta actually had an even more general identity, which we're not going to use here. But in the present instance, the identity is as follows. If a, b, c, d are distinct positive integers, every integer of the form a squared plus b squared times c squared plus c d squared can be written as the sum of two squares in two different ways, as is written down here. For instance, if a is 1, b is 2, c is 3, and d is 4, we have 125 as the sum of two squares, n1 squared plus n2 squared, You can write it either as 2 squared plus 11 squared or as 5 squared plus 10 squared. And the energy level 125 times constant is therefore a 4-fold degenerate energy level instead of just a 2-fold degenerate energy level. The next slide, please. So the spectrum is given by the set E capital N proportional to capital N, where capital N runs over all those positive integers that can be written as N1 squared plus N2 squared, where N1 and N2 are positive integers. What's the degeneracy of this level, E sub N? It's the number of ways in which a capital N can be written as the sum of two squares, N1 comma N2, being regarded as distinct from N2 comma N1 when N1 is not equal to N2. Well, here's where some interesting number theory enters the picture. This N, capital N, can be written as a sum of two squares if and only if its prime factor decomposition does not have any factor of the form p to the power r, where p is a prime which is equal, congruent to 3 modulo 4, and r is an odd number. Perfect squares are also counted in this statement. Well, this looks like a little bit of an intricate argument, a condition here, and indeed it is, because it's the number theory is involved, but in the next slide I show you what it really implies. We use a result due to Gauss on the so-called sum of squares function to derive an exact formula for the degeneracy of the nth energy level, G of N, capital N. You can deduce it as follows. Let D1 of N be the number of divisors of N of the form 4J plus 1, where J is a non-negative integer, including 1 and N itself if it's applicable. In other words, if N itself is of the form 4J plus 1. And let D3 of n be the number of divisors of n of the form 4j plus 3, with the remainder 3, including n itself, if applicable. Then one can show that the degeneracy of the n energy level labeled by capital N is D1 of n minus D3 of n if n is not a perfect square. And if it's a perfect square, since this number theoretic function counts the sum of squares function, counts the perfect squares, you need to get rid of that. So there's a 1 subtracted out. And this is the exact answer for the degeneracy factor for general n. If gn turns out to be 0 for some n, then e sub n is not in the spectrum. If it's equal to 1, then the level en is non-degenerate, and so on. And in the next slide, we see how the series progresses. If you put capital N, these are the allowed values of capital N, the first few allowed values. And g sub n oscillates between 1 and 2. And it's generally 2. But there are further examples. If you go to higher values of capital N, like this, then Gn keeps increasing and sporadically increasing, and it goes up, it can even go up to 12. When the quantum number is 5525, the energy level is 12-fold degenerate, and so on. This number theoretic function varies really wildly as capital N increases, becoming as high as proportional to square root of N asymptotically. This sort of additional degeneracy is restricted to a subset of the spectrum. It arises purely from number theoretic properties. It's not directly connected to any dynamical symmetry, but it's very interesting nevertheless if we're to explore further what happens here. How am I doing on time? Would somebody tell me how much time I have left?
Hare Krishna? Hare? Maybe you can take
you can have some 15-20 minutes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Can I go to the next slide, please? Similarly, if you consider a particle moving freely inside a circle of radius A with its center at the origin O, we have now a circular stadium, and the circular wall is a perfect reflector. Classically, you again have two constants of the motion, such as the Hamiltonian and the orbital angular momentum about the center of the circle. And once again, the problem is integrable. In the quantum mechanical case, we may therefore expect a discrete spectrum. The next slide, please. Well, we have now to solve a radial Schrodinger equation, which is called the Bessel equation. It's a little intricate, but I'm not going to bore you with this. We're going to go straight to the next slide, please. And skip this because I want to get to more interesting parts. And skip the next one too. Yeah. So the sum and substance, I hope you're seeing exactly what I'm seeing on the screen. Yes. So the sum and substance is that the energy eigenvalues in general are degenerate, doubly degenerate in this case, and you can write down all the eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. There are some interesting technical questions involved here regarding Bessel functions and the zeros, but I'm not going to get into that here. Suffice it to say that showing that in this problem, showing that the nodes occur at points which are distinct for different wave functions requires a result which was proved by the mathematician Siegel only as late as 1930 or 1939 or so. So there's some historical mathematics involved here, which I'm not getting into at the moment here. But let me go straight to what I call dynamical billiards. So we can find the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions for a particle called a billiard in classical dynamics, moving in other sufficiently symmetric two-dimensional regions in principle. When the classical Hamiltonian is integrable, the motion is sufficiently regular or non-ergodic, classical integrability requires a second isolating integral independent of the Hamiltonian in two dimensions. The next slide, please. Interestingly, other than the square and the circle, which we've looked at, integrable cases include equilateral triangles, right triangles, rectangles, and ellipses, among others. In the case of an ellipse, for instance, other than the Hamiltonian, the second constant of the motion happens to be the product L1, L2 of the angular momenta of the particle about the two foci of the ellipse. In the corresponding quantum mechanical problem, what's required for integrability is the separability of the del squared operator as well as the boundary conditions in a suitable set of orthogonal coordinates. And finally, there are connections between classical superintegrability, namely dynamical symmetry, and the degeneracy of the quantum mechanical energy levels. But let's not go into this aspect here. The next slide, please. If the particle happens to be move in a region which I call a stadium, in which the classical motion is not integrable, then there exist sets of initial conditions of non-zero measure for which the motion happens to be chaotic, classically. Of the numerous examples studied, a prototypical one is called the Sinai billiard. This is a particle moving inside a square stadium of size L, but with a disc-shaped obstacle or scatterer of radius A less than half L at the center of the square. This defocusing effect of the convex shape of the scatterer causes a separation of initially closed particle trajectories, leading to dynamical chaos in the classical case. The origins of chaos in a classical gas, actually, physical problem, can be traced back to this basic situation. And in the next slide, I show a figure of this Sinai billiard. So you have a square stadium with a circular obstacle, and you can see from where the arrows start that if you had two different trajectories which hit slightly different sides of the midpoint here on the circle, their future trajectory is completely different altogether, and there is actually exponential separation of trajectories in this problem, and there is chaos. There's a little relevance here to a physical gas, which is known to be chaotic. Even if you had just two particles, and even if one of the particles is absolutely static, as is in this model situation, you still have dynamical chaos, because you don't have a sufficient number of constants of the motion which are analytic. So this is the basic origin of dynamical chaos in macroscopic systems. There are many other situations as well, but this is a very, very notable example. The next slide, please. What happens quantum mechanically? Well, when the classical motion of a billiard in a stadium is chaotic, the corresponding quantum mechanical system displays what's called quantum chaos. The energy level patterns appear to be random. The level distribution statistics show features similar to those of random matrices. The positional probability density plots show quantum scars, namely the density is enhanced along classically unstable periodic orbits, etc. I should mention here that these are topics of ongoing research. They include the connections between these features and multiparticle entanglement, the so-called eigenfunction thermalization hypothesis, the variety of related aspects. The next slide, please. Well, again, the free particle on a sphere is something that I'm going to skip. So we'll skip this. This has to do with geodesic motion on a two sphere. Again, the analog of a ring in one dimension is a sphere in two dimensions, two dimensional space. And there is Gaussian curvature for this space. And the question is, what's the effect of this curvature? So let me skip the next two slides. Or three slides. And go to a different topic altogether, the inverse problem. So would you please do that? The next slide, please. Just skip the slide. The next one, we'll skip this. Yes. So far, we've looked at the problem of finding the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions of the Hamiltonian of a particle moving freely inside some domain with a perfectly reflecting boundary. And the problem amounts to finding the eigenvalues of the operator minus del squared with Dirichlet boundary conditions on the boundary. These eigenvalues are in the physical problem of particle in a box. They are 2m over h cross squared times the energy eigenvalues. Now we ask a different mathematical question altogether. Suppose you're given the full spectrum of minus del squared in some region under Dirichlet boundary conditions. What can we reverse engineer and deduce regarding the region itself? In particular, does the spectrum determine the domain up to an isometry, namely up to a translation and rotation of the region? This is the interesting question to be asked. In the next slide, we see that this is the so-called famous question, can you hear the shape of a drum? It is a famous question, not so-called, the famous question, the so-called, can you hear the shape of a drum? A very picturesque way of asking, given the spectrum of the Laplacian in a certain region, with Dirichlet boundary conditions, for instance, can you deduce what the shape of this region is? The answer actually turns out to depend on the kind of domain. For convex domains with a smooth boundary, it's yes, we can do so. For general non-convex polygonal domains, the answer is no. It took a long time to establish, as we'll see in a minute. For non-convex domains with analytic boundary, the answer is not known even now. In any case, the general answer is no. And there's a systematic procedure to generate distinct or non-isometric domains that are isospectral, namely have the same spectrum. The next slide. I show the picture of two regions originally deduced by Gordon, Webb and Wolpert in 1992 in a paper entitled, One Cannot Hear the Shape of a Drum. Look at the two congruent, non-congruent regions shown in the figure. In the next slide, these two regions have the same area and the same perimeter, the same number of corners, the same number of corners with 135 degree angles and 90 degree angles. The spectra of del squared or minus del squared are exactly the same for both, and yet they are not isometric to each other. So you cannot hear the shape of a drum even if you had perfect pitch. The next slide, please. Here's a simpler example of the same phenomenon, and many more examples have been constructed since then. And there's a systematic procedure for doing this. The next slide, please. The isospectral domain problem has been investigated in higher dimensional spaces and curved spaces as well. But we must remember there the Laplacian operator generalizes to what's called the Laplace-Beltrami operator. Let's now turn very briefly to the more general question of what information about the domain that the spectrum of minus del squared actually carries. So the next slide, please. The problem is the following. You have an countably infinite spectrum of the form 0 less than lambda 1 less than equal to lambda 2, etc. for the operator minus del squared. The eigenvalues are real and positive, including the eigenvalue lambda 1. In the context of a particle in a box, this guarantees that the ground state energy is strictly positive. Then what's the link between the set of eigenvalues and the geometry and topology of the domain concerned? This involves some advanced mathematical analysis, and I'll just give a quick summary of the results here. The next slide, please. Skip that. The next one, please. Yes. So we have a set of formulas called the Weyl formulas. In a planar, let's look at it in the two-dimensional case. In a planar domain R of area A and perimeter P, let's suppose that n of lambda is the number of eigenvalues of minus del squared on this region with Dirichlet boundary conditions that are less than or equal to lambda. Then as lambda tends to infinity, the mean number n of lambda, summing over, smoothing over fluctuations, rapid fluctuations due to number theoretic functions, goes like a term proportional to a lambda, then a term which is proportional to lambda to the power half, plus etc., but multiplied by the perimeter, etc. So there's geometrical information here. The coefficient of lambda to the power 1, the leading term, gives you the area, apart from the 4 pi constant, of the region. The next term gives you the perimeter, apart from this constant, etc., etc. The next term is of order lambda to the 0, gives the number of holes, the number of sharp corners, etc., etc. here. So we have detailed geometric information about the domain from this asymptotic expansion of the function n of lambda, which is the number of eigenvalues less than or equal to lambda here. These are the so-called Weyl formulas here. So there's direct information on this. This minus sign here is applicable to Dirichlet conditions. If you had Neumann boundary conditions, this would become a plus sign here between A and B. The next slide, please. What happens in higher dimensions? Well, the corresponding result in the three-dimensional domain was actually an outstanding problem in the early years of the 20th century, when they had the problem of counting the number of modes of the radiation field inside a black body cavity in the effort to deduce Planck's law, the law of black body radiation. As we know today, the law was finally discovered, derived properly after Bose introduced Bose-Einstein statistics and applied it to a photon gas. Well, the three-dimensional counterpart of Weyl's formula for a domain of volume V and surface area S again has a leading term proportional to the volume multiplied by lambda to the 3 halves, a next term which is proportional to the surface area multiplied by lambda, and then there's a term here proportional to lambda to the power 0 half, and then lambda to the 0, and so on. The lambda to the half term is going to be proportional to the mean curvature of this domain, the surface of this domain, and so on. So once again, there's detailed geometrical information and topological information available about the domain from the spectrum of the Laplacian or the generalization of the Laplacian. Next slide, please. And last of all, there are these so-called trace formulas, which involve considering what's called a partition function g of u. So introduce a real positive variable u and consider e to the minus lambda I u summed over lambda j u summed over the eigenvalue index j. If you let u go to 0 from positive values, each term in the sum tends to 1 and the series diverges. G of u is singular at u equal to 0 because of this divergence. We need to find out what this divergence is like and what's the power of u by which it explodes as u goes to 0. That is where the trace formulas come in. It's an asymptotic expansion for G of u as u tends to 0. And again, for a two-dimensional domain of area A and perimeter P, this g of u is proportional to the area divided by power u to the power 1. The next term is proportional to the perimeter divided by u to the power half, and then a term of order u to the power 0. In the three-dimensional case of our domain of volume V and surface area S, g of u is proportional to V divided by u to the 3 halves, a term proportional to the surface area S divided by u to the power 1, plus a term proportional to u to the power minus half, plus order 1, etc. And this constant alpha, the coefficient of the term proportional to u to the minus half, is in turn proportional to the mean curvature of the surface. And there are many, many other such deep results pertaining to the spectrum of the Laplacian or manifolds. And this is an active area of research, continues to be so in mathematics and mathematical physics. The next slide, please. I've come to the end of my talk, skipping a few details in between due to lack of time. So we've seen that the problem of a particle, both classical and quantum mechanical, and you'll notice that throughout I've always referred to the corresponding classical problem as well. That's the best way to learn it, classical and quantum mechanical counterparts in one shot together, looking at the similarities and the contrasts as well. So the problem of such a particle moving inside a domain with reflecting walls is a paradigm or model with remarkably wide and diverse ramifications. These ramifications range from direct physical applications to nanostructures, nanowires and nanostructures, quantum dots, etc., to studies in semi-classical quantization, quantum chaos, statistical mechanics, and so on, as well as to problems and results in many areas of mathematics, such as functional analysis, variation and calculus, group theory, harmonic analysis, differential geometry, and ergodic theory, to mention just a few of them. So I conclude by saying, by asserting, that the particle in a box problem is really, truly a paradigm in both classical mechanics as well as quantum mechanics. And I hope I've given you a flavor of what this problem entails in its various aspects. This is all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Balakrishnan. Maybe a few questions.
Sure.
If there can be asked.
Chatter, sir, please.
Very nice talk by Professor Balakrishnan. But of course, for me, some things have gone in, but some things are completely out. But whatever I grasped, I just want to ask a few doubts in that, more of a for clarification. You talked about, when you talked about the billiards,
okay, yes.
You mentioned a word called non-ergodicity.
Mm-hmm.
When you say, is it, and then they lead to the chaos, okay? Because the trajectories are not, they end up in two different trajectories leading to the chaos. Is it because you are not allowing the billiards to collide? Is the absence of collisions is the thing?
Okay. Good question. The billiards problem generally deals with just one particle. So okay. It's a single particle inside a region,
okay,
which is called the stadium. Uh-huh. And then you impose boundary conditions, which is perfect reflection, specular reflection at the boundaries. So it's a single particle, it's not particles. The Sinai billiards, for instance, had a fixed scatterer. So the second particle wasn't moving at all. It was a much bigger object and it was just a circular obstacle with a different symmetry than the square box in which it was placed.
Okay. It's not okay.
So, if the motion is non-ergodic, if it's ergodic, it means a given trajectory will come arbitrarily close in phase space to every point in the phase space, allowed part of the phase space. If it's non-ergodic, it's restricted to a subset of this phase space, and the motion gets more and more regular. So the hierarchy of random motion in classical dynamical systems goes something like this. First, you have simple periodic motion. Then you have multiply periodic motion with commensurate frequencies. Then you have multiply periodic motion with incommensurate frequencies, and that's quasi-periodic motion. Generally, that turns out to become ergodic. But it is not mixing in the sense that there is no separation of nearby initial phase trajectories.
Okay.
Then you have mixing of various kinds, including strong mixing finally, where the separation is actually exponential. And then you have exponential instability in portions of phase space, but not others. So on the average, exponential divergence of trajectories with positive Lyapunov exponents. And finally, you have everywhere exploding phase space, everywhere exponentially diverging phase trajectories, which is called a Kolmogorov system or some K system or whatever. So that's fully developed chaos in that sense. It's completely hyperbolic everywhere. Then beyond that, you have systems which are as random as a coin toss, which are the so-called Bernoulli systems, like the various kinds of shift maps, etc. So there is a hierarchy of increasingly chaotic behavior. Mm-hmm. And the implication goes in one direction. Mixing implies ergodicity, but ergodicity doesn't imply mixing, etc. And when you have this... fully developed chaos, then you have non-trivial positive Lyapunov exponents almost everywhere in phase space, and many other interesting things happen as well. At the moment you lose integrability in a Hamiltonian system, you are guaranteed that you have at least a set of non-zero measure initial conditions for which the motion happens to be chaotic. So Hamiltonian chaos is very special in that sense.
One more question related to your inverse problem. You said you can never, from the spectrum, you can never identify the source shape. Okay. But if you, in reality, we can say, for example, you can, from Veena, you can produce another sound, etc. So is it because there are something called characteristic spectrum? There is a common or some commonality of the spectrum. So if you go to the characteristics, which probably with certain boundaries, etc., probably that part of the spectrum, if you see, probably you would be able to identify some amount of shape. Elusive. So is it
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, yes, this is a mathematical question. It's in some sense a technical question. In practice, if I restrict my shape to smooth analytic boundaries, like a circle or something like that, or an ellipse or something, then yes, the spectrum is decided, decides the shape completely, apart from an isometry like rotation or translation or something like that. But otherwise, in general, you saw the kind of regions, the non-convex polygonal regions that were shown as examples of isospectral but non-isometric regions. They were fairly complicated. Nobody, of course, is going to produce a musical instrument with that sort of shape.
Yeah.
But the fact remains that in principle, if you have non-convex polygonal domains, it turns out that the spectrum of the Laplacian on these domains with Dirichlet boundary conditions is not enough to fix the shape of it. That's all. That's what was the problem. Well, interestingly, the problem, this impossibility, was first proved by Milner way back in the 1960s, and he proved it not for manifolds which are two-dimensional, like a drum head or something like that, which is what Gordon et al. Did in 1992. The two-dimensional problem was open for a long time, but he actually proved the non-isometry of two isospectral 16-dimensional flat tori. So just to show you that mathematicians can have deep imagination even of objects which you cannot physically conceive of very readily. He did this in the 16-dimensional case. And of course, that immediately showed that the isospectral problem was in some sense settled, that you could have non-isometric isospectral regions. The problem has seen further generalizations, because it's not just minus del squared eigenspectrum that's involved, but so-called elliptic operators. There's a very robust and very active theory of this in mathematics.
Yeah, I just, my last question. This inverse problem again, if I do an excitation, okay, that is, and the system response, okay. So, with respect to that, probably I will be able to determine the shape, right? For example, if I have an instrument, the way I write it, okay, the response of one instrument is different from another instrument.
Yes. Yes.
So, that if you want to solve, probably one can get the shape part of it.
Something else is involved here. So, when you have an actual instrument, when you excite a system, not only do you excite, if you give it enough energy, you're going to excite a large number of modes, but there's also the question of what is the amplitude of each of these modes. Okay. And much of what we appreciate as music has to do with the careful balancing of the different relative amplitudes of different normal modes of the system, because it's never a single normal mode that's not interesting musically. But the mixture of these modes with the relative amplitudes or intensities, that's what produces the aesthetics in the music here. That's the second aspect of the problem. What's the actual excitation that you've given to the system, and how has it been done? That determines, as you know, what happens subsequently in any musical instrument. That's quite true. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Very nice.
We have time for a few more questions.
Hello.
Can I have a very cute question, sir?
Yes.
Thank you, Professor Balakrishnan. You mentioned in the beginning there is no H-bar present, but your definition of K has 2MVA divided by H bar square, right?
Yes, yes, correct, yes.
So why that statement is important, that there is no H bar present in the problem?
Oh, I see. I wanted to merely point out that you cannot have an H bar sticking out. In K, yes, because notice that K has dimensions 1 over length.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So when you multiply it by length, KA, it becomes a dimensionless number, which is the argument of the sine function, etc.
Yes.
So that's all I was trying to say, that there is no, I was trying to point out that there is no prefactor, or I should have made this very clear. There is, the prefactor cannot contain anything other than 1 over square root of length.
Yeah,
if H bar appears anywhere, there's no other parameter to cancel the T that is sitting in H bar. Because H bar is ML squared T to the minus 1. And there's nothing to cancel that T if H bar appears bare, unless you have another time scale in the problem. That's the way I should have said it.
One more quick clarification. The inverse thing you are discussing is relative to Helmholtz operator, or it's a general thing that
the simplest of these elliptic operators is of course the del squared operator, and the Helmholtz equation is an eigenvalue equation for minus del squared.
Yes.
But one can generalize some of these theorems, many of these theorems, to so-called elliptic operators, of which the Laplace-Beltrami operator is the simplest or most direct one. So there is possible, I'm not a mathematician, so I don't have the details on what are the possible operators, but there's a whole family of operators and called elliptic operators for which this has been done, and the so-called index theorems, etc., play a role in this business here. So it's not restricted to just minus del squared, although that's the first example. It's a standard example of an elliptic operator.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
The first question is, what will be, if we have a particle on the surface of a three-dimensional torus, will the eigenvalues of that problem and the eigenvalues of particle on a ring, will there be some relation between them?
Oh. Offhand, I don't know. The particle on a ring is a trivial, straightforward problem because the angular momentum is conserved and that's the end of it. Now, on a torus, you have to be much more careful. I don't know offhand if there is any directly discernible connection. The point is that the torus is not like a sphere, as you know, because yes. The sphere you have a Gaussian curvature, but torus is a developable or parallelizable manifold. So what complications that poses is not very, doesn't come to mind readily. Yeah, sorry, I don't have a ready answer to this.
Okay, so second question I have is, if we have a closed surface and that has a little bit small opening, some radius, and if we put a particle inside it, can we calculate when will the particle come out? Can we calculate like, okay, in this, what's the probability of the particle escaping out of that closed surface?
What is the kind of motion that you're allowing for a particle? Let's take a sphere, for instance. I didn't have time to look at the sphere problem in detail, but let's look at the geodesic motion on a sphere. The motion, if it's a free particle, would go on geodesics, right? They would move on, the particle would move on great circles, depending on the initial conditions. So there's not much dynamics here because all it's doing is free particle, except that it's seeing the curvature all the time.
Okay. And so there's a difference between a classical motion and a quantum particle motion.
Oh yes, definitely. Okay. Definitely. classical motion, you start with the Lagrangian of the particle on the surface, and it's just the kinetic energy term, but it's got this non-trivial curvature of the problem. Therefore, the motion will be on great circles. Quantum mechanically, one can quantize this problem completely, because classically it's integrable. So one can quantize it and find what the energy eigenvalues are. And there are two functions of two quantum numbers, which I didn't have time to show. But, yeah. Now, if you put a hole in that, and then it becomes a different problem altogether. So it's not a priori clear what would happen.
I mean, if it's moving inside the sphere.
Oh.
Yes, that's what my question. If it's moving inside the sphere, what will be the dynamics of it? What can we say about the dynamics if it's moving inside the sphere?
Well, what are you going to allow? I mean, are you going to place the whole, imagining the whole thing is in a field of gravity or?
No. If it's a free particle, and if for a classical particle, then it will reflect and there is some interesting dynamics. For a quantum particle, what would the dynamics look like if you place it inside some vessel?
But now you're saying that the vessel is of it can escape from the vessel. Geometrically, it's a much more complicated problem. I don't know what the boundary conditions that you want to impose are, so it's not a
For example, if a particle is inside an infinite dimensional potential in a box, so we can say that it will move in some way. If we take the geometry and extend that to say in a sphere. I was thinking what the dynamics look like.
Well, look at it even in a box with a finite potential well, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then the particles, certainly it has got free motion outside the box, right? I mean, there are positive energy solutions outside the box, outside the well. That's certainly permitted. And then you have a set of bound states when the particle is inside the box. So in general, if you give me a container, that's what will happen, isn't it?
Okay.
Then there's some energy levels discretized inside the container, and some free motion outside.
Okay.
I mean, offhand, that's what one would expect, but now we make the situation complicated enough and put curvature in the space and so on. I don't know how to. There's a well-defined procedure for doing quantum mechanics on curved spaces.
Okay.
So if the particle moves in a curved space, there's a well-defined way of doing quantum mechanics on that, defining momenta and defining variables, etc., canonical variables, etc. So that is not the difficult part. Whether it's quantizable or not, this is not very clear to me. I don't know.
All right.
So there are a few questions posted in the message box. Can you share this? Last few.
Can somebody read it out? Can
one morph a two-dimensional square into a circle and study relations between degenerate states in one to the other, to another? But more generally, what does this morphing preserve, or is it even allowed?
Oh, morph in what sense? I mean, the square has sharp corners, so are you going to permit that to happen in the circle, or are you going to? It's not clear. You see, the square, let's look at it purely classically. The square has symmetry under the interchange of x and y coordinates, right? The circle, on the other hand, has rotational symmetry. It's a continuous symmetry. So the spectra are very different in the two cases. In the case of the square, you have what's called pseudo-integrability. Because you can ask, what happens to a trajectory of a classical particle which is shot in such a way that it heads straight for one of the corners of the square? What happens to it after that? In what way is it going to reflect? The answer in the Billiards problems is that those trajectories are sets of measure zero, and you omit them. You drop those omit. You say that whenever something heads straight for a corner, like in a carom board, it gets into a pocket and disappears, and that's it. So you drop those trajectories altogether. So the symmetry of the problem is very different. In the case of a square, classically, what is constant is the square of the x component of the momentum and the square of the y component of the momentum. Quantum mechanically, these quantities are not constant at all. In a circle, these quantities are not conserved at all. they both change, px and py both change. What is conserved is xpy minus ypx, which is the orbital angular momentum about the center here. Now, for a shape which is like an oval, smoothed out corners of the square, you don't have angular momentum conservation. There is no symmetry of this kind at all. You have a different kind of symmetry, which is again the x to y symmetry, and that's all that you have. So you don't have this transition to a continuous symmetry, which you have in the case of a circle. In the case of the ellipse, you do have it, but the symmetry, the conserved quantity is not, it's not circular symmetry. In some elliptic coordinates, there will be symmetry in the problem. But what is conserved is the product of the angular momenta about the two foci of the ellipse, along with the Hamiltonian. That makes the system integrable. So the question asked in each case is, what is the symmetry of the domain that you have? What's the symmetry of the boundary conditions? And then, is del squared separable in a suitable coordinate system or not? So this is what is needed for integrability. In the quantum mechanical cases, it's only the simplest of problems for which you have sufficient symmetry to be able to say that I can write down the eigenfunctions explicitly. In all other cases, it's much more intricate.
Yeah, I just want to add another question since we were on my... Yeah, so this question was... So regarding... So I recently came... I was learning about the path integral formulation of quantum mechanics and how that could also kind of give you... So for simple examples such as a 1D case of a particle in the box, I can get the eigenstates from that function as well. And you said in your talk about how you can't hear the shape of the drum, as in there may be two distinct shapes, but they have essentially the same spectrum. Mm-hmm. Now, can it be so that if I looked at all the paths and gave them all amplitudes and then added them up as we do in the path integral formulation, and then maybe the paths are similar for both these shapes. So these shapes might be different looking. However, all the paths that can be made in one shape can also be made in the other. And that's how we could probably argue that maybe their spectrum must be the same, even though they look different. Is that, I was just thinking.
I see. That's an interesting idea. I don't know the answer. I don't know if it would make it easier. In general, the path integral formalism, even for simply solvable problems, is fairly intricate, isn't it?
Right.
It's equivalent, but very intricate. For instance, you try doing the path integral problem for the hydrogen atom. And this has been done, but incredibly, fairly complicated, right? So I don't know the answer to whether people have thought about the isospectral problem in the language of path integrals. I really don't know. I'm not sure it would make it easier.
Maybe, but yeah, I mean, I was just trying to reduce the problem to a more geometrical issue, as in if I could just kind of find equivalent paths of one shape to the other, and just argue that maybe that way the spectrums will be the same, because then the summation will essentially be the same. But
I haven't thought about this aspect at all. It is true that when you want to look at whether a particular stadium is integrable or not, in the more complicated cases, without obvious dynamical, without obvious symmetries present, then you need to write down all possible orbits, even in configuration space, and separate them into distinct classes, etc. And then there is a long procedure to find out what the integrability criterion is. That's in configuration space. Now, what you're suggesting is actually in the path integrals is more intricate than that. So, it's an interesting thought, but I don't know the answer to whether it will shed any light on the isospectral problem.
Sure.
I don't know.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Professor, then can we move on to, you want to speak something about your answer, sir, at the end of the lecture?
Pardon me?
You wanted to speak something about Valsasar at the end of the lecture, or you have already?
I already mentioned in the beginning. That's all I mentioned. Well, there are many other things we could talk about. I mean, our days in Kalpa come together, very pleasant memories. My only regret is that we did not have closer interaction, even though the distance between Chennai and Kalpakkam was fairly small, except for the brief interlude in the early 90s when we collaborated on some papers. We are co-authors. Essentially, we worked independently and then we just decided to write joint papers. But apart from that brief interlude, unfortunately, there was not much occasion because our preoccupations went diverse for collaborative work. Although we stayed in touch, definitely. Occasionally, there would be an email from, there'd be a message from him, no email in those days. There'd be a letter, a handwritten letter with a mathematical problem, which he found interesting, purely for the joy of solving the problem. It'd be like a little challenge. So I've had some communications with him in that regard. He'd try to pose a mathematical problem for the other person to solve. So there were a few of those. My great regret, we didn't have stronger collaboration. It was an opportunity lost in that sense. I did get a lot of, indirectly, I heard about Valsa's activities in Kalpakkam, because one of the things that was most notable, looking at it from outside, was not only his technical prowess in physics and related areas which he worked on all the time, but also the great interest he took in tutoring students at the plus two stage. He and along with KP and Murthy and a few others kind of single-handedly ran a kind of gurukulam, so to speak, a kind of school outside school for children who are interested in mathematics and physics and sciences in general at a very impressionable age. And I'm sure the benefits of that are now slowly emerging among the generation that's now up and coming. So that's a service whose value cannot be counted in words, because it's really a very singular thing that he did.
You see, those days there were no these coaching classes. In fact, that's where the KPN and Valsa has really helped Kalpakkam students, whether Sundar Purnaya and many other kids. They all cut into IITs and and also inculcated a good amount of physics.
Yes.
Even though that is, I would say, is these two people have really contributed.
Yes, yeoman service. And most unfortunately and regrettably, sorrowfully, neither of them is with us now. So this is a tragedy.
Sir, can we move on to the next?
Yeah, if the lecture is over, then it is.
May I just interject for a second? I would like to apologize personally to the entire audience because this network of mine has been extremely unstable today, and this inhibited my talking today. So it was not as natural a flow as I would have liked it to have been. Entirely because I was constantly nervous about these flashing messages which I was getting on my screen about my network being unstable.
But so I think
that,
overall,
I'm sorry about that.
Overall, it was fine. Initially, there was some problems, but overall, it was fine.
Well, I must say, you people are very forgiving, but anyway.
Thank you, sir.
Indeed, we had a great moment with you. So I hope some others also want to speak in memory of Professor Valsa. Professor Sebastian, sir, is there?
Yes, he is.
Yes, I am here.
Yeah. Please, sir.
I shall say a few words. I hope you can see me now.
Yes.
Yeah.
And hear me.
Yeah. Yeah. Very well.
Okay. Thank you very much. I would like to thank the organizers for arranging this wonderful lecture by Professor Balakrishnan in memory of Professor Valsa Kumar. And of course, Professor Balakrishnan did a wonderful job. I mean, very nice job. In fact, coming to my own interactions with Professor Valsakumar, they have not been very long actually, because I met him only in November 1996. I had just retired from Institute of Science and I was visiting IIT Palakkad because the director had asked me whether I would like to join IIT Palakkad. And so I went there. And I met him on the day of my visit. In fact, I spent 2 days there in the IIT Palakkad interacting with the faculty members. And Professor Valsakumar was one person with whom I spent almost a full day talking. Because you see, I do have some interest in physics. And so I found that there was a lot of things that was common between him and me. And therefore, I spent a lot of time. In fact, I found that he was a gem of a person and a very smart physicist. And one of the major reasons why I decided to join IIT Palakkad was actually Professor Valsakumar's presence there. So I joined the IIT in 2017, and I had Professor Valsakumar as a colleague for less than 2 years. But during that time, I became very close to him. Surprising how short our interaction was. You see, I became a very close friend, essentially because I admired his many abilities. He was a wonderful physicist, as I said earlier. And not only that, he was a most caring human being. And his wife, Leela, became a very close friend of mine. And there are many, many experiences that I could talk about, but I shall speak about only a few, because I know that it is getting late. First of all, he was a fantastic researcher. Whenever I, as Professor Balakrishnan mentioned, whenever I had some problems, I used to go and discuss with him. And the discussions were very productive. And of course, you see, I also somehow did never write a paper with him. And in fact, whenever I visited the Indian Institute of Science, Professor Ananda Krishna, who was in the material science department of IASC, would always ask about Valsakumar and express his great admiration for Valsakumar. Then coming to teaching, see, Valsakumar was unique, as Professor Balakrishnan again mentioned. He's a whole department by himself. He can teach any topic in physics. In addition to that, he also would teach any course in mathematics for which teachers were not available in IIT Palakkad because it was just starting at that time. And in fact, I remember he taught a course on stochastic processes to the engineering students, and the students were extremely happy with it. And whenever I went to his office, I would always find students surrounding his table, clearing their doubts. Coming to his administrative abilities, he did not actually want to do administration. But then you see, given the circumstances in the IIT, that was impossible. So when he was asked to do some administration, he very gladly took it. And he was made the dean of students, and he did that job again very well, in fact, admirably. And he was very friendly with the students, and the students simply loved him. Now, as I said earlier, he was a very caring person, and in fact, he was one of the most kind-hearted human beings that I have known. Now, towards the end of 2018, I had to undergo bypass surgery, and I was recovering from the surgery in Bangalore. So I was away for about 3 months, and it was during that time that I heard the news that he had passed away, and I was very shocked. And we could meet his wife only much later. Now, let me just summarize, because you see, I know it is getting very late. In summary, Professor Valsakumar was a wonderful human being and a great scientist. I consider it a privilege to have known him for only for 2 years. I wish we could have been friends for a much longer time, but that turned out to be not possible. I myself and my family would join you in remembering him. And I would like to express my heartfelt condolences to his wife and daughter. And as I said, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to speak to you and to listen to the wonderful lecture by Professor Balakrishnan. Thank you all.
Thank you, Professor K.L. Sebastian. I think we are already, as Professor Sebastian said, running out of time because we have started around 10:30. Now it is past 12 o'clock. So I think it's time to wind up. I know that many of you have nice memories to share with us, but however, because of lack of time, so may I take this opportunity to invite Dr. Seema to pay the vote of thanks.
A warm good afternoon to one and all. It's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks to all the attendees here for the Professor M.P. Valsakumar Memorial Lecture. For a great teacher like Valsakumar sir, a lecture like today is a tribute. On behalf of Academy of Physics teachers, Kerala, and all gathered here, I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to our chief guest and speaker of the day, Professor V. Balakrishnan sir, who spared his valuable time from his busiest schedule to grace this occasion. So today we had an opportunity to hear your class in Google Meet and the ideas of tackling a problem. I'm sure that this will definitely encourage each one of us in our future events. On behalf of APT and all gathered here, I would like to thank the president of APT, Professor Titus K. Matthew, who is very keen in conducting all the activities. I would Dr. G. Balakrishnan, who always work hard from the beginning to execute an event more efficiently. On behalf of Academy of Physics teachers, Kerala, and all gathered here, I would like to thank the family members of Professor Valsakumar sir, his friends and students also. I would like to thank all APT members, teachers, students, and all gathered here once again. Thank you all. Have a nice day.
Over to Harikrishnan. Anything else, Harikrishnan?
Nothing else, sir. Thank you once again, Professor Balakrishnan.
Welcome.
Thank you all for those who have attended. Many persons could not join this Google Meet because initially the limit was reached. 100 persons were already there. I think those could join our YouTube live stream, and we will make this live stream available at the APT YouTube channel. And as some person has requested, after talking to Professor Balakrishnan, we would like to make available the PDF of this presentation also. We will try to do that. So thank you.